Is America an Islamic country? This Homeland Security advisor thinks so.
He's one of the select advisors within that group to influence policy.
How the Muslim Brotherhood infiltrated our government.
The enemy is inside the wire.
Plus,
but I got in that car, didn't look back.
A teen takes off for Christmas.
I told him to take me anywhere but home.
Find out what brings him back.
Well, welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to this edition of the 700 Club. You think it's cold here. They just announced a record in Antarctica. You know how cold it was? It was minus 135 degrees.
Whoa.
130. It's the coldest they've ever recorded. And it, forget that global warming stuff. I mean, they've had a couple of records down there.
And when was that? 2010?
10,
wow. I mean, unbelievable.
But it's still kind of chilly. You go up to Minnesota, it gets to be minus 20, 30.
I'm a Wisconsin girl. We're used to that. A little wind chill factor added to that.
I was in Duluth. I think it was minus 20.
Duluth is cold.
It really is cold.
Yes. Yeah. I hope you're having coffee in Duluth this morning.
So it's snowing in Washington, snowing on the East Coast, but it's not snowing in Virginia Beach. It doesn't snow here. It's the garden spot of the world. Terry?
Well, it's not going to be minus 135 from the mid-Atlantic to New England today, but the region is getting hit by yet another winter storm with snow, rain, ice, and as Caitlin Burke reports, it's proving to be a nightmare for travelers.
50 million Americans all along the Northeast Corridor are waking up to winter weather advisories and storm warnings.
I'm pretty concerned. I'm driving all the way from Frederick, so I guess I had to leave a couple hours early.
Snow's forecast today from Washington to Boston. Some areas could see as much as 5 inches. And for travelers, that's more bad news.
On Monday, 1,700 flights were canceled, including more than 100 at Chicago O'Hare, one of the busiest airports in the nation. Dallas has been a mess since last week, some travelers stranded for days.
We were in New York City for a nice weekend and didn't get out and were put on standby and standby and standby.
We do have a lot of road equipment and we're continuing to work on it.
And driving isn't going any smoother than flying. Outside New York City, at least 36 people were injured in this massive 24-car pileup. And it appears from this home video that parked cars aren't safe either.
Holy freaking moly.
Ice from freezing rain brought down power lines Monday night, leaving well over 120,000 homes and businesses in Virginia, West Virginia, and Maryland in the dark.
Tree fell at the end of the street and blocked the entire street, took down one power pole, which then took down another, which took down the third.
Forecasters say this winter has already had an unusual amount of snow. As of Monday, it's covering almost 67% of the U.S. Caitlin Burke, CBN News.
But it's really caused by global warming, folks. It's the emissions of carbon that are causing all of this cold. If it's too cold, it's global warming. It's too hot, it's global warming. If it's too much rain, it's global warming. If it's too dry, it's global warming. Sooner or later, they're going to start blaming it on the sun. Well, leaders from around the world come to remember a historic figure in South Africa. John Jessup has that story from Washington. Here's John.
Pat, tens of thousands paid tribute to Nelson Mandela at a memorial service in South Africa today. Mandela was remembered as a symbol of reconciliation and a man with a mighty power of forgiveness. Mourners streamed into the 95,000-seat World Cup soccer stadium near Johannesburg early Tuesday. A joyful crowd sang and danced to Mandela's name. More than 90 countries flew in representatives from Argentina to Pakistan, Trinidad to China. The President and First Lady Michelle Obama arrived early this morning. Former President George W. Bush, his wife Laura, and former Secretary of State Hillary Clinton joined the President on the 16-hour flight from Washington. Former Presidents Bill Clinton and Jimmy Carter separately also made the trek to attend. President Obama was one of several invited to eulogize the anti-apartheid icon.
Mandela taught us the power of action, but he also taught us the power of ideas. The importance of reason and arguments, the need to study not only those who you agree with, but also those who you don't agree with.
After today's memorial, Mandela's body will lie in state for 3 days before burial on Sunday. Well, back here at home, not only will many people not be able to keep their doctor under Obamacare, they may not be able to keep their current prescriptions either. That's according to Forbes magazine public health and regulation analyst Scott Gottlieb. He writes that the problems stem from the structure of Obamacare itself and how the different plan works. He points out many drugs may not be covered at all. You can find his analysis by going to our website at cbnnews.com. Pat?
That's what happens when you let a Yale or a Harvard academic draw up your health care. Ezekiel Emanuel, to my knowledge, had no medical training, and if he did have it, he sure didn't show much of it in this bill. But he tries to defend it. It's indefensible. It is an absolute monstrosity. And we've got to fight, folks, against the encroachments of the socialist mentality that want to control everything. That's the way they are. They want to control everything, and if you don't agree with them, they'll put you in prison. I mean, that's the way it works. We can't have that in America. This is the land of the free, the home of the brave. We've got to remember where our roots are. And our roots do not lie in Barack Obama. He has a different philosophy from the average American. John?
Pat, in late November, the U.S. and other world powers signed an agreement with Iran. And just minutes later, they disagreed on what it said. As Chris Mitchell reports, some Israeli experts are warning those differences could leave the door open for Iran to build nuclear weapons.
After Geneva, Israel's former ambassador to the UN, Dori Gold, examined what the U.S. said about the agreement and what the Iranians said. He briefed diplomats and journalists at the Jerusalem Center for Public Affairs.
So my team started translating statements made by President Hassan Rouhani, who said, dismantling our nuclear facilities, that's a red line. So there's a huge gap that's coming down the road.
Gold said the gap includes a major difference on sanctions. After the signing, U.S. Secretary of State John Kerry said the architecture of the sanctions remains in place.
What does Rouhani, the president of Iran, say in Farsi, in Persian language? He says the exact opposite. He says, no, we're going to fracture the architecture of sanctions, using the American term.
Americans and Capitol Hill share Gold's skepticism about the agreement. 62% say Iranian leaders aren't serious about addressing international concerns about their nuclear program. On Capitol Hill, there's bipartisan support for a bill authorizing more sanctions. The White House and Iran object to that legislation, and Iran's foreign minister tells Time magazine that if Congress approves any new sanctions, the Geneva deal is dead. Gold believes the West needs to know what Iran is doing.
Those of us who sit in the Middle East and see what Iran is doing on the ground, but what few people know is that the bloodbath in Syria is being both directed and manned by Iranian soldiers coming from the Quds Force, the overseas units of the Revolutionary Guards. Now, if you want to get a stable relationship between Iran and the West, Iran's got to cut out this behavior.
Gold warned Iran is going the way of another rogue regime.
I'm convinced that they will do what North Korea did, which was to evict the inspectors, to say the world is weak and we can do whatever we want. I know this is politically incorrect, but if you want a safe and secure world, you don't give the most dangerous weapons to the most dangerous regimes.
Given the different interpretations after the Geneva Accord, many experts here believe Iran feels it has a green light to pursue its nuclear program. Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Jerusalem.
Pat, how long do you think it'll be before this deal may fall apart?
Well, as far as the Iranians go, it never existed. So as far as the Americans go, we will want a fig leaf. Obama doesn't want to admit a failure, so will it fall apart? Well, it'll of its own weight. But you think back to the days of Munich, when a guy with an umbrella, as Churchill called him, that silly old man with his umbrella, not Churchill, but Hitler called him that, Adolf Hitler, Neville Chamberlain, he went over there and Hitler just absolutely bamboozled him. But the Allies, France and England, had more power than the Nazis. and they had treaties that they could have enforced from Versailles that would have kept the Germans from arming Alsace-Lorraine and that area in the middle, which they had been agreed under treaty not to do. But did the Allies enforce? No, they didn't. And then when Churchill got to Munich, he gave up Czechoslovakia. Czechoslovakia at the time had one of the most robust armies in Europe. And Hitler said, well, the Sudetendeutsch, we've got to set them free. And Chamberlain says, okay, Mr. Chancellor, if that's the way it is, as long as we can get peace, comes back, waves his umbrella in the air. I was just a youngster then, but I remember it. I mean, it was just imprinted in your mind, holding up that umbrella and say, we've got peace in our time. What a joke. If the Allies had put it to Hitler then, they could have spared 50 million lives that were lost during World War II. But they didn't do it. And the United States is following the way of Munich. And our Secretary of State and our President look very much like Chamberlain. They look weak. And it's a question of whether or not people in the Senate, for example, can do something to change it. And I know that one of the senators is an ardent supporter of Israel. And so John can tell us more about that.
Pat, Senate Democrats are using the new power they granted themselves to put more President Obama's picks for judges on America's top appeals court. 2 weeks ago, Senate Majority Leader Harry Reid used the so-called nuclear option to wipe out the longstanding Senate rule on filibusters. That rule let the minority party hold up nominations. Senate leaders are taking steps to give Democrats a three-seat majority on the U.S. Court of Appeals for the District of Columbia, often called the second most powerful court in the country. It's the court most likely to hear challenges against any executive actions taken by President Obama. Well, Oklahoma leaders say Satanists will not be allowed to erect a monument at the state capitol. A spokesman for the New York-based Satanic Temple wanted to donate a statue and put it next to a monument of the Ten Commandments. But legislators say that plan is far from reality. And members of the committee that would need to approve that monument sounded skeptical. Senate President Pro Tem Brian Bingaman says such a display at the Capitol would be inappropriate. Exercise is the best lifestyle choice you can make to cut the risk of dementia as you get older. Researchers at Cardiff University in the UK studied key habits in more than 2,200 men since 1979. They found the best habits to avoid disease include exercise, a healthy diet, low body weight, not smoking, and a low intake of alcohol. But they found that exercise is the best way to keep your mind healthy as you age. And Pat, the study's lead investigator, says exercise and healthy behavior is more beneficial than any preventive procedure or medical treatment you could ever get.
You're absolutely right. Berries, nuts, oat bran. Mm-hmm. What do?
Well, I like that too. I don't do it every morning, but you do. I know you're faithful to that.
Do you? Well, I just don't like to eat anything else. Do you exercise?
Yes, I do.
Good
I
for
walk
you.
On a regular basis.
Do you?
Yeah.
Well,
mm-hmm.
It's been raining and I can't ride my horse. I let him exercise and I get the benefits of it. Yeah. It's good for his cardio when I'm out there on him. Okay.
That's good. Well, coming up, he's the senior Homeland Security Advisor for our country, and guess what?
He goes to bat for the Muslim Brotherhood. He is passionate that they are the moderate good guys that the U.S. needs to ally with. All the Muslim Brotherhood supporters had a specific sign that they put up on their Twitter and their Facebook pages, and he was right along with them.
And that's not all he's done that will shock you. Stay tuned for more.
Fifth grade was a struggle. I mean, it was hard for him.
The teachers didn't really understand what was happening with me.
I mean, he was very stressed out.
At K-12, we think every child deserves the best chance to succeed in school. Now there's a tuition-free choice for kindergarten through 12th graders, an online public school powered by K-12. K-12 offers flexible schedules and programs customized for each student. The award-winning curriculum is taught by highly qualified teachers. Textbooks, videos, and materials are all included free. To find out more, call or click today.
That student
has no way to fall through those cracks at all because the parent and the teacher are working so hard together that they're gonna succeed.
Since starting online school and being at home, his whole demeanor has changed.
Don't wait. Make a choice that can change the course of your child's life. For your free information kit, call or visit k12.com today.
Tomorrow, the gift that keeps on giving.
That's marriage insurance.
How a blitz in Kentucky is divorce-proofing marriages.
The best gift that you're going to give each other is to come through this counseling.
Plus, meet Mr. Color himself.
I was born with the ability to see color like many people don't see it.
And take a Christmas tour of the spectacular Greenbrier Resort on tomorrow's 700 Club.
Well, if you watch this program, our next feature might not shock you, but to the average person, it ought to horrify them. Because can you believe this? A member of the Obama administration has said, and I quote, "The United States is an Islamic country." He isn't just another bureaucrat. He has a senior role on Homeland Security Advisory Council. And he's been tied to the Muslim Brotherhood, which says jihad is our way and death and jihad is our goal and so on. Eric Steichelbeck brings us this alarming story.
This provocative statement created a firestorm last month because of its contents and the author's government role. "I do consider the United States an Islamic country with an Islamically compliant constitution." The tweet by Mohammed El-Ebiari raised eyebrows thanks to his senior role on the Department of Homeland Security Advisory Council, where he helps craft America's counterterrorism policies. It's a position one analyst says El-Ebiari is not fit to hold.
He goes to bat for the Muslim Brotherhood. He is passionate that they are the moderate good guys that the U.S. needs to ally with.
Ryan Morrow is a national security analyst for the Clarion Project. He's interviewed El-Ebiari at length and says the senior Homeland Security advisor staunchly supports the radical Muslim Brotherhood.
He had the symbol that was most closely associated with the Muslim Brotherhood from when the Egyptian military cracked down on them. All the Muslim Brotherhood supporters had a specific sign that they put up on their Twitter and their Facebook pages, and he was right along with them.
El-Ebiari has praised Muslim Brotherhood icon and al-Qaeda favorite Saeed Qutb and spoke at a 2004 event honoring Iran's Ayatollah Khomeini. In addition, CBN News reported in 2011 that El-Ebiari stood accused of leaking sensitive government documents to the media. In light of those charges, Texas Congressman Louie Gohmert pressed former Homeland Security Chief Janet Napolitano in a heated exchange.
"Are you saying before this Congress right now that as Secretary of Homeland Security that it is a lie that Mohammed El-Ebiari downloaded material from a classified website using the secret security clearance you gave him? Are you saying that's a lie?"
"I'm saying that is inaccurate. That is correct. He, as far as I know, did not download classified documents. What bothers me, quite frankly, are the allegations that are made against anyone who happens to be Muslim."
"Well, the allegations are not because he is Muslim."
It is still unclear whether any formal investigation of El-Ebiari actually took place at DHS. What is clear is El-Ebiari's recent promotion at the department.
In September 2013, he was promoted. So he not only is an official advisor, he's one of the select advisors within that group to influence policy.
El-Ebiari and the Department of Homeland Security did not respond to CBN's request for comment. El-Ebiari is not the only Obama administration advisor who's been tied to the Muslim Brotherhood.
"There's lots of evidence. The President of the United States personally takes counsel from Mohammed Majid, and that means the enemy is inside the wire."
Majid has reportedly met with President Obama to advise him on immigration and counterterrorism policy. He also sits on a Department of Homeland Security working group on, quote, violent extremism. Yet national security expert Frank Gaffney told CBN News that the organization Majid leads has troublesome ties.
"He is the president of the largest Muslim Brotherhood front organization in the United States, the Islamic Society of North America.
In 2007, federal prosecutors named ISNA as an unindicted co-conspirator in the largest terrorism financing trial in American history. The defendants were convicted of funding the terror group Hamas. Majid's group was also mentioned in secret Muslim Brotherhood documents uncovered by the FBI.
The very first group on this Muslim Brotherhood strategic plan was the Islamic Society of North America.
Despite ISNA's radical track record, President Obama delivered a video address at the group's annual summit this year.
Assalamu alaikum, and congratulations to Imam Majid and everyone at the Islamic Society of North America on your 50th annual convention.
One leading Egyptian newspaper recently claimed that the Brotherhood is stepping up its efforts to infiltrate the United States. It identified what it says are 30 Brotherhood operatives that are currently conducting influence operations on U.S. soil. Eric Stackelbeck, CBN News, Washington.
Eric, shocking, but ladies and gentlemen, you're hearing it here in the 700 Club. And what are we going to do about it? Just wring our hands and sing Silent Night and Jingle Bells? I mean, let's face it, we have a president who either doesn't know what he's doing or is deliberately trying to undermine some of the foundations of this nation. It is very serious what is happening. And while this is going on, while he's cozying up to the Brotherhood, he's losing influence in Egypt. He certainly lost influence in Saudi Arabia. He's losing influence in Europe with our allies there. Nobody trusts us anymore because we are so vacillating in our approach to these important matters. The Muslim Brotherhood founded the Palestine Liberation Organization. They founded Hamas. They founded and controlled the organization that is arrayed against Israel in the Middle East out of Lebanon. This is a terrible radical Islamic front. And they are not a group of peace lovers. They are out for jihad. They're out to destroy the Western governments. They're out to spread Sharia and to establish the caliphate throughout the world. So we are going to welcome them into the secret councils of Homeland Security to tell us how we can defend ourselves against Islamic terrorism. This is ridiculous. Whew. I could say write your White House, but I don't think they pay any attention. Yeah.
That might not be where you want to send the letter.
I don't know where you send the letter. You complain to your congressman, but something's got to be done
about
this.
Terry? Just shocking. Well, up next, a 17-year-old who disappeared on Christmas Eve.
I was part of a church play, but nobody knew that I had secretly arranged for some friends to be waiting in a car so that I could walk out off the stage and leave.
When we got home without him, I walked directly to his room. My wife walked in with me. We were kind of numb.
Find out what brought this prodigal back home.
Jack and I are having the time of our lives. The kids are on their own, and now we're back in control of our time and the way we spend our money.
That's why Consumer Cellular is the perfect cell phone company for us. We get great service, and compared to our old plan, we're saving a ton every month.
Consumer Cellular is the wireless provider for people who want affordable service without the contracts.
Listen, I don't think I'm cheap. I only
want to pay for what I need.
So what do you pay a month for Consumer Cellular?
My bill can be as low as $10, $15 a month.
Wow. But we can change our plan anytime. So even those months we use it a lot, we're always getting the best price.
Try Consumer Cellular risk-free for 30 days with free activation, a $35 value, and free shipping. Consumer Cellular is the exclusive wireless provider for AARP members. Ask about your special discounts.
Call Consumer Cellular at 1-800-730-5103. Go online to consumercellulartv.com or visit a Sears store today.
With Basic Talk Home phone service, you can make unlimited, crystal-clear domestic calls for just $9.99 a month, every month. But if you don't believe me, listen to this Englishman with a British accent.
Quite right.
Basic Talk, just $9.99 a month. Call, click, or go to Walmart today.
This Christmas, share the ultimate life with someone you love, based on the best-selling novel.
A legacy is your family.
The Ultimate Life, on Blu-ray and DVD today.
Christmas. Okay. It's the most wonderful time of the year to be with your family and friends. But what if they don't want to be with you? That's exactly what happened to the parents in our next story. Their 17-year-old son ran away on Christmas Eve. But these parents never gave up hope that one day he'd come home.
It's always a tug in my heart towards music.
He could carry a tune as a little toddler.
I was just inspired by the music that I saw.
And it was an incredible feeling for me when I would see him at the altar and sometimes broken and weeping and you know, just with his hands lifted.
I became cynical about church probably around 12 years old. I think there was a point when I just saw too much of the church politics, backtalk, gossip. And, that was about the time some friends of mine were starting a band. The band started off as, you know, a bunch of Christian guys, but we all kind of suddenly realized that that wasn't who we really were and what we wanted to do. And so musically, we started to kind of veer off into weird land.
This is one of the clubs that I used to play at as a kid. 16, 17 years old, sneaking in. A lot of my anger at God, anger at the church, anger at myself was coming through the music.
I would go to these clubs and start hanging out with older people and some of the wrong crowd, and drinking was involved. And So, my parents did the right thing. They were grounding me and they were saying, hey, that's gotta go. I left home when I was 17, Christmas.
We were at church. I remember we were at church and I didn't suspect a thing.
Well, it was Christmas Eve and I was part of a church play, but nobody knew that I had secretly arranged for some friends to be waiting in a car so that I could walk out off the stage and leave.
And right behind me, that's the church that we were holding the Christmas pageant at. So I told them to take me anywhere but home.
I started looking for him after church and couldn't find him. None of his friends were telling me any information about where he was.
But I got in that car and just took off and didn't look back.
And when we got home without him, I walked directly to his room. My wife walked in with me, and we're standing there together, I remember, and just we were kind of numb.
What I experienced the most was just absolute loneliness. I remember not being able to eat a lot, and I was missing school. I was sick, hungry, cold, sleeping in someone's car. It was pretty bad. Eventually, the band started picking up more shows, and the last person I expected to see in the back of the hall was my dad.
I came to this club and walked in, went immediately to the back wall, and I came to see my son. I was really concerned about what he was doing, and I don't think he knew I was there. I didn't want him to know I was here. I wanted to see him.
I think he was just there just to show me that he still loved me and that he was praying for me. About 5 or 6 months later, after running away, somebody got a hold of me and said, hey, your dad's going on a trip to Austin, Texas, and was wondering if you'd like to come along. I called my dad. It was the first time I talked to him. And he's like, hey, you don't have to go to the worship conference. I just thought we'd go see a movie and go get some food and just hang out in Austin.
Just like I was cutting some of the kids from church some slack, I kind of felt like maybe I was putting too much pressure on my own kids.
I don't know, it was just something about the way he was just kind of offering to, you know, be friendly. And I said, yeah, you know, I'll go with you.
It was a matter of waiting and trusting God.
And after the conference, we're driving home and my dad's like, where do you want to be dropped off? And I honestly didn't have a place to stay.
Right behind me is the spot where after that trip to Austin, my dad dropped me off and I said goodbye. And didn't know if I'd see him again.
And he took off down the road. And my wife and I sat there and we cried. It was a sad time. But we prayed also.
I wandered around for about a couple hours and just was wondering what my next step was. And I knew in my gut that I wanted to just pour my heart out and say I was sorry.
And I called my dad and just said, you know, what can I say? Is there any way that I can come home? Will you guys forgive me?
It was an incredible feeling, and just that he was calling and that he was really reaching out, and so we went.
He came with my brother and my two sisters and my mom, and they showed up and they
They picked me up and hugged me, and I just remember weeping and being overwhelmed with, you know, guilt and shame and forgiveness and love and all those things just kind of washing over me and being received back into my family.
And not long after that, he went with me to a Bible study.
The leader of the Bible study handed me a Bible and said, hey, why don't you just open it up to Psalm 139 and just read to us what you see there.
When he began to read, I mean, I was like overwhelmed immediately.
It's this idea of God loves me even though I've been running. God's waiting with open arms even though I've rejected him. I remember reading verse 1, verse 2, verse 3, and then just choking up and not being able to read anymore.
I saw the tears down his cheeks. They fell on the open Bible. It was a very dramatic night.
I knew I could not go back to being in the band that I was in or being the person that I was. I said, I'm giving my life back to God. And so I would go to the coffee houses and I'd start playing and singing, and just felt right, you know, to sing about my faith.
I see how it was God orchestrating some of these things. And we just really, really are thankful and grateful for that work of the Lord.
And once I allowed him to be everything in my life, he gave me back music, and I was able to use it for his glory and for his kingdom.
What a story. You know, the only time that we have a picture of God running, has to do with the father of the prodigal son, who, in a sense, stands in the role of God. He ran to his son and threw his arms around him. God will run to you and throw his arms around you. He loves you. And the father loved that prodigal son who'd wasted his substance with riotous living. He'd spent all the money he had, spent his inheritance, just was out with the pigs. He said he fain would fill his belly with the husks that the swine ate. And this young man we're looking at, Gabe Martinez, he thought, just get me away from my family. I can't stand all this religion stuff. I can't stand all these rules. I can't stand all this. The way outside is hard. The way of the sinner is hard. It's hard out there. It's lonely, and it's cold, and it's thankless, and you're subject to abuse. But there's a father who loves you. There's a father who loves you and says, come home, child. I've got a home for you. I've got a wonderful place. Yes, there's presence and there's feasting and there's joy in my father's house. Now, if you want that joy, why don't you just stop fighting, stop running, stop playing games, and say, okay, Lord, you're right. You created me. You know what's best. And I submit myself to your control. Pray these words with me. Will you do that? Pray with me. Jesus, that's right. Pray now. Jesus, you know my heart. I've run away from you. I've turned my back on God. I've scorned the things of your love. But Lord, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. And like the prodigal son, I want to come home. I want to come home, Lord. I want to come home this Christmas. Hear my prayer, Lord. I come home to you. Take me. Make me your own. And forgive my sins. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, if you prayed with me just then, I want you to do something. I want you to give us a call and say, look, I prayed with Pat. I gave my heart to the Lord. It's 1-800-759-0700. Call right now. 1-800-759-0700. There it is, 0700. If you call, I want to give you a little book that will help you start out What do you do next? You just pray the prayer. You just let the Lord come into your heart. But there's a lot more. There's a lot more to understand. There's a lot more that will be a blessing to you. And for that reason, I did a CD, 73 minutes, I believe, of compact teaching that you understand what you just did. I'll give all this to you free. It's absolutely, it's beautifully done, but it's yours for free if you just give me a call and say, I prayed with you. I have given my heart to Jesus. 1-800-759-0700. The phones are there. For any reason they're busy, they'll call back. They'll be available. We have many phones here and in our studio in Nashville. 1-800-759-0700. Here's Terry.
Well, still ahead, a fitness buff who coughed so much, he blacked out.
I couldn't even climb a flight of stairs. I was coughing so bad, I couldn't even order a sandwich at the deli.
Find out how he was healed in an instant. Plus, we'll be praying for you and your needs, so don't go away. We'll be back in a moment.
There's something that's missing. And I want to tell you that that something missing is Jesus.
It was the beginning of a road of redemption for me.
There's forgiveness, there's a new life, there's everything in trusting God. Just take that one step, that's all it takes.
I felt like a new person, brand new creation. I felt like I had had a weight lifted off my shoulders.
This is a special announcement for anyone with joint discomfort who's been disappointed by products that have failed to provide the relief they were seeking. Complimentary samples of a revolutionary joint relief breakthrough called Beneflex are now being made available to the public. The unique Beneflex formula contains a clinically tested, patented ingredient that's so effective, you only need to take one pill daily. Just one pill. And you can begin to experience joint relief in as few as 7 days. To guarantee your complimentary 2-week sample, you must call now, 1-800-940-5957. Again, if you have joint discomfort and have been disappointed by products currently available, complimentary samples of a powerful new quick joint relief formula are being made available to the public. To guarantee your sample, you must call now. Beneflex is available at GNC and Vitamin Shop, but you can only receive your complimentary sample by calling this number, 1-800-940-5957.
Welcome back to the 700 Club. Well, it's legal to say Merry Christmas in public schools in Texas, and the state's making sure that everyone remembers that. The state legislature gained national attention when it passed that measure this past summer. The bipartisan law also protects symbols like Christmas trees, menorahs, and nativity scenes, as long as more than one religion is represented and a secular symbol like a snowman is on display. The Republican who sponsored the law says it's intended to keep censorship of Christmas out of public schools. Conservatives are hoping similar measures will gain momentum across America. The makers of the hit TV Bible series are gearing up for another religious historical drama, The Dove Keepers, this time for CBS. TV producer Mark Burnett, and his wife, actress Roma Downey, scored a major hit with their miniseries, The Bible, on the History Channel earlier this year. The Dove Keepers is about four women who worked to save 900 Jews under siege by the Roman army at Masada. Downey called the novel an amazing story of heroism and hope. CBS announced it will air a four-hour miniseries based on it sometime in 2015. And you can always get the latest from CBN News by going to our website at cbnnews.com. Pat and Terry will be back with more of the 700 Club right after this.
Connie and I love having cell phones because of the freedom they give us. So why would we want to be tied down to a contract?
Life's too short.
And Consumer Cellular gives us control over how and when we use them and what we pay.
And compared to our old plan, we're saving a ton of money every month.
So what really sold us on Consumer Cellular was that they're the exclusive wireless provider for AARP members.
AARP? That's a huge deal.
Was it complicated to switch?
Not a bit. They make it super simple. You can even keep your number.
Oh, that's nice.
Consumer Cellular, affordable service without the contracts. Try Consumer Cellular risk-free for 30 days with free activation, a $35 value, and free shipping. Or just pick it up at a Sears store. Plans start as low as $10 a month.
Call Consumer Cellular at 1-800-393-4301. Go to ConsumerCellularTV.com or visit a Sears store today.
Call now for your chance to win a 1 ounce gold bar from Capital Gold Group by answering this question correctly. Which president took the United States dollar off the gold standard? Was it A, Ronald Reagan, B, Richard Nixon, or C, Franklin Roosevelt? All calls are free. Limit one entry per person. Call now with your answer for your chance to win a 1 ounce gold bar. Call 800-385-GOLD. 800-385-GOLD. 800-385-GOLD.
Tomorrow, the gift that keeps on giving.
That's marriage insurance.
How a blitz in Kentucky is divorce-proofing marriages.
The best gift that you're going to give each other is come through this counseling.
Plus, meet Mr. Color himself.
I was born with the ability to see color like many people don't see it.
And take a Christmas tour of the spectacular Greenbrier Resort on tomorrow's 700 Club.
To listen to our top songs of the week, go to CBN Radio at CBN.com.
Marty Ludick likes to keep himself in top shape. So when he got to the point where he couldn't climb stairs or even just breathe normally, Marty knew he needed help.
Fitness has always been a lifestyle. I've always worked out. It's a big part of my life.
Marty Ludick exercised daily and considered himself healthy. So when he developed a little cough, he wasn't alarmed.
Initially, it was just a dry cough, just a subtle dry cough.
But it quickly got worse.
I was coughing so bad, I couldn't even order a sandwich at the deli. Toward the end, I couldn't even climb a flight of stairs. I would cough to the point where I was blacking out.
Doctors diagnosed Marty with sarcoidosis, a collection of inflammatory cells that commonly attack the lungs. He was given steroids to reduce the inflammation. The meds took care of the cough, but there were consequences.
I felt very weak. I felt very listless. I didn't have much energy. It was terrible. I couldn't wait to get off it.
When Marty went off the steroids, the cough came back.
I was praying for the Lord to heal me, to take it away. So I was just waiting for the Lord to move, waiting for his timing.
One evening, Marty was watching the 700 Club and heard Pat Robertson praying.
Somebody else with lung problems, you just breathe in and breathe out, and your lungs are healed.
And it just ended. That was it. It was gone. It just dissipated. I knew it was gone without a shadow of a doubt. So I was excited, and I couldn't wait for that confirmation from the doctor.
His follow-up appointment confirmed his lungs were normal, and the sarcoidosis was gone.
His word is clear. By his stripes, we are healed. My words can't express how grateful I am adequately to the Lord for healing me, as well as everything else he's done for me in my life.
Words can't express. When God touches your life like that, it is powerful.
I didn't know Marty, and we tell these things. I don't know Marty. I didn't know he had a lung problem, but God knew it, and God touched him, and the power was there. We've got some prayer requests. We have these beautiful little things we've sent out to you, and you pop these little jewels out and put your prayer request in and send them back to us. And somebody says, I need healing of our marriage. Mm. Somebody said, my kidneys need to be healed, and I need salvation and deliverance from anger.
Mm. All right. Here's somebody saying, I need healing from diabetes. A woman saying, I need my husband to find a good paying job. And then someone else saying, healing after a severe car accident. I think as we read these, it's wonderful for all of us to remember that God knows each and every need, hears every prayer.
And he is completely able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. He can do more than we can ever conceive of. So the deal is, stop fighting it. Stop just begging and begging and begging, and surrender to the Lord. You've got a diabetes, surrender to the Lord. You've got a financial thing, surrender to the Lord. We're going to pray together. Terry and I are going to join hands right now, and we're going to believe God. Father, in Jesus' holy name, Terry and I join together, and we ask for an anointing. We ask for a miracle in the lives of people. We surrender these needs to you. Lord, money. There are people who need money.
Yes,
and I ask, Lord, that you might just look upon them, and from the bounty and the riches that you have in glory, Send forth a blessing to these people at this Christmas. Send a blessing. People need peace. Their marriages are torn up. Lord, let them love each other. Let love flow down like a river. And Lord, for those who are looking for peace, may peace come upon them in the name of Jesus. Mm-hmm. Terry, what do you have?
There's someone with a mild form of Asperger's. God is healing that condition. Someone else, you have mental confusion, and it's not just distressing to you in the moment, but it's frightening to you. God's healing that condition for you.
Thank you, Lord. A neck muscle, just reach up here and touch it. In the name of Jesus, you just got healed. The pain has gone away. A spirit of infirmity is leaving many people right now. Shoulders, necks, backs. Right now, the pain is leaving. You just feel it just leave you instantly. In the name of Jesus, just praise Him for it.
Someone else with very painful bone spurs in your heel, almost impossible to walk, gone in Jesus' name.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Father.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Call and bring. Tell us what the Lord has done for you. We'd love to hear from you. 1-800-759-0700. That's easy to remember. Mm-hmm. Good news.
Very good news. And by the way, we want people to know that, you know, if you haven't gotten these and you'd like to have some prayer requests sent in, we'd love to pray for you. Yeah. So call that number and ask for them as well. We'll get it
out
to
you. One
you
hang on your tree, the other you pop out and send in. All right, what do you have?
Well, up next, we're going to bring it on with your email. Mary Lou asks, how can you summon angels to visit? Stay tuned to find out after this.
Christmas, the wonderful time of year when we celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ, the light of the world. 700 Club partners, this is the perfect time to make your celebration complete by helping people who are in desperate need. Your special donation to CBN will provide gifts like food and warm clothing, life-giving water wells, and even livestock that will help support families all year long. Look for your special Light of the World prayer ornaments in the mail. Return one with your prayer request, then hang one ornament on your tree as a reminder of God's gift and our prayers for you. Share the light of God's love this season because so many others need your help, and send in your prayer request so that we can pray for you. You'll be a blessing, and you'll be blessed as well.
Walls separate people, Jose. Just like the high rates that phone companies charge you when you call internationally. So we're breaking these borders down.
So people can call Mexico as much as they want.
Mexico!
India! Brazil!
China!
Think big. Over 50 countries.
Why not 60?
Now you're just talking crazy. Crazy generous.
Hand it off!
Well, it's time to answer some of your email questions. Pat, this first one comes from Mary Lou, who says, how can you summon angels to visit?
Well, I want you to know that we can't summon them, but what we can do is ask God to send them. And I do think we can say, Lord, send the angels. And if He wants to send the angels and answer prayer, we're asking for help. The angels are sent to watch over the heirs of salvation. I don't think each one of us has a, quote, guardian angel. I don't think that's biblical, but they are sent to watch over the heirs of salvation. And so they're looking after us. So we can say, Lord, send the angels. And I think that He will answer, but you can't, quote, summon them. You're not.
Yeah, they don't come to just visit.
Yeah, they're not that powerful. So don't think, if you're summoning stuff, you're summoning the wrong kind. All right.
This is a viewer who says, will you go to hell if you commit suicide?
That is something that we don't have a clear answer to. You know, at law, somebody who commits suicide is presumed to be crazy, insane. And somebody who's insane is not going to be able to comprehend right and wrong. That's the idea. But people who know very well what they're doing and they plan out their suicide, I think they're tempting eternity. And I don't have a clear scriptural understanding of every part of it, so I can't, you know, be precise. Mm-hmm. But I'm just saying, anybody who commits suicide is tempting the possibility of spending eternity in hell, and that is just horrible to contemplate.
Yes.
Whatever's going on bad in your life is going to be much, 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 much worse in hell. All right.
This is a viewer who says, I've heard that the, quote, age of accountability is 8. But are there kids that young in hell? I read a book and a woman said she had a vision of hell and saw kids that young there. But I just don't feel right about this. What are your thoughts?
You ought to feel right about it. Some little hellions at 4 or 5. You feel like they came out of
parenting.
The so-called age of accountability, that's just something we made up. It's not in the Bible.
Is that 8?
No, it's not 8. It's the time you begin to understand right and wrong. It can be 3. It can be 4. Up to that point, a child doesn't know what's right and what's wrong, what's good and what's bad. But there comes a time that they develop a moral sense and they know when they're doing something wrong. And so we have developed in the church the so-called age of accountability, but it's certainly not 8.
No, I thought that that was the age where, in keeping with that, you had the ability to determine that you wanted to be confirmed into the faith of your fathers. And that's usually like preteen or...
Well, it depends. I mean, when you get baptized and all that stuff. But I think, you know, there is no set age. It is a question of when does a person become accountable and understand it. You know, my children, as I recall, they wanted to know the Lord when they were just little fellas, and they wanted to be filled with the Holy Spirit. I mean, they knew it early, and you know, who knows? Okay.
This is Phyllis, who says, what is the difference between a Messianic Jew and a Christian? Do they have different Bibles? Are their beliefs different?
Well, the Messianic Jews are essentially Christians. They believe in Jesus as Messiah, but they are holding on to some of the traditions of the fathers. And there are those who disagree with them on that. They think that, you know, if you're a Christian, you're a Christian, so you don't act with it. You don't have to keep these other things. But I love the Messianic Jews, and I think that what they're doing is we keep kosher. We believe in the Old Testament. We believe in the New Testament. We believe Jesus is Messiah. That's where the Messianic concept. He is our Messiah, and they are certainly born again, and it is a delight to meet and talk to these people. They're wonderful people. Mm-hmm. I don't want to split hairs over this is that or that's the other, because there is a debate over what they should do, but it's not for me to say. All right?
Okay, this is Charlotte, who says, how can I tell if a prophet is of God?
Well, the Bible gives you a test. If what he says comes to pass, then you know it. And if it doesn't, he's not. I think that's the test in the Bible. Mm-hmm. But more than anything, does he acknowledge any spirit that does not acknowledge that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, is not of God? That's the spirit of the Antichrist. So does this prophet talk about God? You look at Jim Jones, for example. He didn't talk about God. He didn't have a Bible in his house. He was talking about all his stuff, but he wasn't talking about Jesus. Does a prophet exalt Jesus as the only way to God? If he is, then that's one confirmation. All right?
Yeah, this is Betty, who says, in Revelation 4:5, it makes reference to the 7 spirits of God. What are they?
Oh, I know this may shock people, but I don't know.
No, I think that's fine.
That's right. Well, it
be
says
released.
A division into 7 spirits. You know, you can read, and the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, the Spirit of wisdom and might and power and so forth.
Right.
You read those, and you know.
Well, there's a lot of mystery in Revelation, no matter how much you study or read it.
7 spirits, but. I think the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me. And then the spirit of wisdom, understanding, fear of the Lord, all those things mm-hmm. are in the Bible. All
right. Very good.
Whew. We got through that one, I hope.
And live to tell about it.
Terry didn't disagree with me. Not too bad. Well, Terry Funches is a grandmother who wants to make a difference. And she's doing just that. She's providing clean water for children all over the world, right from her own living room.
Terry Funchess loves being a grandmother and spending time with her family. But when her daughter was young, Terry faced the reality of divorce and becoming a single mom.
It was my job to go and get myself income coming in that I would be able to support my daughter. It scared me to death.
She found hope in a decision she made years earlier.
I came to the Lord through Pat Robertson saying the Sinner's Prayer.
She joined the 700 Club when she saw what CBN was doing around the world.
They do a lot for the world and people, you know, and people walk 2, 3, 4, 5 miles just to get water and something clean. For the little that we can give, it's like we're doing tons. It makes me feel good to know there's children drinking water.
She knew her giving helped others in need, but Terry now faced financial uncertainty in her own life.
I had this little girl that I had to take care of, you know.
She believed it was important to send her daughter to a Christian school, so she stepped out in faith and started her own bookkeeping business to boost her income.
It was difficult at the beginning when things did get tight for me. And people said, well, why don't you just take your daughter out of school, or why don't you stop giving, you know, to your church and that? And they weren't options.
Terry says that as she gave, her business increased.
So the Lord blessed it. And through that, I believe it's because of the offerings and the tithings, and he just honored my heart. So he's just always been there providing for me. You need to use what you have and to help other people. You just don't know the impact you can have on somebody's life. And I have a real heart for that, and that's why I so believe in what they do.
Oh, we appreciate that. We appreciate so many partners like Mary, the wonderful people. And folks, let me tell you, at the end of the year, the government allows giving to charities, 501c3s, which is what we are, up to 50% of your income, according to certain rules of the IRS. And now's the chance to take advantage of it. You can cut your tax bill if you give before the end of the year. So this is December, we're in the last month, and this would be a wonderful time to do something. And for those of you who join our 700 Club at $20 a month, we want to give you a little DVD called How Shall We Now Live? And I am frankly amazed at the responses. They have been so effusive.
Well, can I share one with you? This is Monty, who lives in Camden, New Jersey, said, How Shall We Now Live is a good lesson about what's on the mind of people in America concerning the difficulties here and abroad. Pat's answers are right on point with what the Bible states. It's brought me closer to God and His will for my life.
Well, we took up the questions that people ask according to the Ipsos survey. We had them survey America. What do you want? What are the things you'd ask God? Well, that's all the time we've got. We want to leave you with today's Power Minute. That's from Isaiah 40:29, where it says, He gives power to the weak, and to those who have no might, He increases strength. That's your Power Minute on this December week. Now, tomorrow, we're going to introduce you to a fascinating guy. He's a dear friend. He's a world-renowned designer named Carlton Varney. And oh man, he's called Mr. Color. You don't want to miss this very interesting interview this Christmas time. We'll see you tomorrow. Bye-bye.
Tomorrow, the gift that keeps on giving.
That's marriage insurance.
How a blitz in Kentucky is divorce-proofing marriages.
The best gift that you're going to give each other is come through this counseling.
Plus, meet Mr. Color himself.
I was born with the ability to see color like many people don't see it.
And take a Christmas tour of the spectacular Greenbrier Resort on tomorrow's 700 Club.
This season, experience the true meaning of Christmas with Christmas Radio on CBN.com. Christmas, a time for being home with the ones you love. A special time to help others. A time to celebrate the best gift of all, Jesus Christ. Cherish this holiday season with the ones you love. Experience Christmas Radio on CBN.com.